Hey everybody, this is Jeff Posnick from the YouTube Developer Relations team, and we're continuing a series of videos about the migration between the older legacy version of the YouTube Data API v2 onto the newer version of the Data API v3. We strongly encourage folks to begin that migration process if you haven't done so yet, and we wanted to highlight certain types of functionality and talk about the v2 way of doing things and how you would go and do the same sort of thing in v3. We're going to start by talking about how you would actually get a list of videos that are in a given channel using v3 of the Data API. Folks familiar with v2 of the Data API know that you do this pretty much with a single RESTful API call. You look for the user uploads feed for a given channel, and you get back a list of videos by default in XML format, although you could also ask for it in JSON format if you want. In v3, it involves slightly different set of operations, and it's just kind of keeping with the overall philosophy with v3 in that you return a very specific set of information for a specific API call rather than returning a lot of information. So it's a little bit more of a focused API. And the other main difference is that in v3, we work primarily with channel IDs rather than legacy usernames. So if you're familiar with the more v2 way of doing things where every channel had a legacy username, you need to kind of start thinking about channel IDs instead. And this is particularly important because moving forward, not every channel does have a legacy username. So if you did want to uniquely identify any given channel, there are going to be those channels that don't have legacy usernames, and you do need to get comfortable working with channel IDs. So let's actually walk through the steps of doing the operation of getting the uploads in a channel using version 3 of the API. And we're going to switch now to a screen share that I have up. And what I have open here is the Google APIs Explorer. This is a great resource for playing around with version 3 of the Data API or using our Analytics API or any other of the modern Google APIs. And it gives you a way of making API calls within the context of this nice browser web form and trying out different parameters. So when you are actually writing code for using this sort of thing in your own applications, you're probably going to want to use our client libraries. But this is kind of a neutral, agnostic way of showing off the API calls. So that being said, there are two different steps for getting the uploads in a given channel, assuming that you know, and we're going to assume right now that we know that channel's legacy username. The first step is to get back the playlist ID that corresponds to the uploads for that channel. And the way we do that is by making a youtube.channels.list call. And we have that open here in the API Explorer. And when making version 3 API calls, pretty much the convention that all the list operations follow is that you have one parameter called part, and you set this to a value that is a little bit dependent upon the given method. And in this particular case, the YouTube channels.list takes these values over here in the documentation. We describe exactly what all of them do, and what we want is the content details part. So instead of returning every single piece of information that we know about the channel in every API response, which could get very bloated, you have to explicitly state what kind of information you want to get back, and you get a nice, really compact API response back. So we're going to say we want the content details part back, and this is how we get the uploads playlist ID. And there's this parameter called for username. As the documentation states, it lets you pass in a legacy YouTube username, assuming that the channel that you're interested in has one. And it will return information corresponding to that channel. So this is kind of like a shortcut of getting information about a channel or looking up a channel's ID if all you know is the legacy username. So in this particular case, we're going to look up the Google Developers channel. That's the legacy username. And we're going to scroll down a bit. We don't need any of these other fields right now. And click Execute. And it's making the API call for us. You'll see these are the parameters. This is the actual RESTful URL that's being requested, and you get back this JSON response. And you'll see over here, because we're only asking for information about one specific channel, the items return array only has one element, not surprisingly. You do get this channel ID right here. If we, you know, didn't want to use that information later on, that might be useful. But in particular context of what we're doing here, we want the uploads playlist ID. So I'm going to just copy that. If you're writing real code, you would obviously save it to a local variable and use it in a follow-up call. And I'm going to now make another API call. And let me just open up a new tab for that. And this is going to be a YouTube playlist items list. And you know, again, the thing to keep in mind is that in version 3 of the API, many things are considered playlists. Like if you, instead of in version 2, where you would go and get specifically the uploads feed corresponding to a given channel, in version 3, you first look up the playlist that corresponds to the uploads for the channel, and then you do the standard YouTube playlist items list call. And this is the same API call that you would use if you were getting information about, you know, a user-generated playlist. It's really quite equivalent. So you'll see that a lot in version 3 of the API, where we kind of reuse methods or kind of overload the function of methods so that they could be used for a variety of different operations. So in this particular case, we have this part parameter again. I'm going to pass in the value snippet here. And snippet is a part that contains the most relevant information about any given response item. Things that would be useful if you were to, for instance, want to display information about the response like in a web browser. So it'll contain like the title for each item, it'll contain a thumbnail, it'll contain a description, and that's the type of information that we want about all the uploads in a given channel. So I am going to take that copied playlist ID and I'm going to paste it into the playlist ID field. This is something to really keep in mind. You want this in the playlist ID parameter. There's a separate parameter called ID, and that takes in something that's different than the playlist ID. So please, you know, this common source of confusion, make sure that you're setting the playlist ID parameter in this particular case. And I'm also going to set max results to 50. One of the things you'll notice is that max results is by default set to 5 in version 3 of the API, which is fine if you are going to be, you know, displaying the results on a web page and you don't want a really, really long list of videos. But, you know, in this particular case, I want to get information about as many as I could in a single API call, and the most you could get back is 50. I'm going to click execute at this point, and you scroll down and you'll see this items array similar to what we saw for the previous one, but in this case the items array has multiple items in it because there are, not surprisingly, quite a few uploads in the Google Developers channel. You'll have information about like when that upload was published and titles, descriptions, thumbnails, things I mentioned before. One other thing that I wanted to point out is the way paging works in version 3 of the API, because this is something that's different than version 2 as well. So previously in version 2, you could kind of pass in whatever you wanted as the start index, and that would allow you to jump to different places within something like an uploads feed. In version 3 of the API, we don't take in a start index parameter. We take in what's known as a paging token. And that gets returned in the API response, and it's used when you build up your next request as a way of saying, hey, you know, I've gotten this page of results, give me the next page of results. This allows for certain efficiencies on the server, and it means that you get a more reliable paging experience when you're using version 3. It just allows things to be a little bit more efficient, and it means that less likely to be duplicates or things that are unordered. So let's actually take in that next page token value from this response, and we're going to construct the next page of requests by pasting it in here. So we're going to have all the same parameters, but we're setting page token now. And if I click execute, things should return back. But in this particular case, I get a different set of results. This is basically results 51 through 100. And we could continue doing that. Basically, as long as there's a next page token returned, that means that there is another page of results that you could get back, and you could loop more or less until you stop getting back next page tokens. As soon as that stops being returned, you know that you've reached the end of the list. So hopefully that's a good overview for how you would do something in version 2 and then how you would do the v3 equivalents. Stay tuned for future shows that cover more topics in version 3 of the API. And thanks so much for joining us. Again, I'm Jeff Posnick from the Developer Relations team. And stay tuned. Cheers.